So let me take off from where I left the other day in terms of how to write a book review. We discussed a certain beautiful layers of looking into a book beyond its surface. Like it is a common metaphor of, you know, just going and witnessing a lake or a deep well. When it is very clear, you can see deep inside the surface. It's just like you are almost, you know, a kind of a deep sea diver when you are a reader. Because some people dive on the surface, they understand certain things. But some avid readers, what they do is, they dive very deep into the text. Like, you know, like an explorer. Just go and explore the beauty of the ocean. Maybe you may end up in, you know, witnessing beautiful coral reefs. So it is reading a text is like that. Where some of you may read on the surface and some of you may actually try to dive deeper and deeper into it to have a clear view of what the author means. So I don't know how pertinent my metaphor is, but that is the way I want you know, you to read a particular book. I'm sure most of you do that as students of literature. So as we keep, you know, scaling or raising the bar, naturally, our perception towards the text will also vary. So in that regard, I would like to make, you know, two or three more pertinent points on how to read the text. Although we have actually dissected some of the ways to read a text, today let us move on with the segment two of how to read, how to review a text. Not actually read a text, how to review a text. And as I said, this dictum of reviewing is not only confined to, you know, book reviews. You can apply that to a movie review or reviewing an article or whatever. So let me share my screen and take you through the remaining part of my presentation. And as I said, I'll stop at last and take some of your interactions pertaining to the discussions of the last class. So I'll share my screen and continue my presentation. Am I sharing the screen?
Yes, sir.
So to reiterate what I said, you know, the reason why there is a microscope in this photograph is when you see certain things with a microscopic eye, you tend to have a better vision of things. Similarly, how do you look at a text with a microscopic eye? Which means you understand not only what is written on the surface, but it will also give you a cameo of the author's life and his thought process and his psychology about his perceptions of the things. One important point I would like to make here is your constant engagement with the writer. You need to engage with the writer, where sometimes you argue with the writer. You have refutations with the writer. There are certain points that he might echo, which is very similar to what you feel. So you have to ask these questions, like, you know, relate to the strengths and weaknesses of the book. What is good? What is bad? So analyze both, you know, and very importantly, what did the author do well? Naturally, but you need to have more advanced reading skills to understand in what areas the author did not do well. I think we touched upon it in our last class. And whether you liked his approach or not, whether you agree with him or not, if you disagree, why you disagree? Or is he very biased in trying to depict something? For example, let's say you come across a writer and let's say that you have a lot of feministic orientation towards the text, but you believe that the author is depicting women in a way that you do not like. Naturally, you will have an aversion, and that you will say that in your review. Probably you may even brand the writer of male chauvinism. So we live in a democratic country. We always have the right of voicing our dissent, voicing our dislike, voicing our contempt, voicing our disregard, voicing our dislike, voicing your apprehensions, and that is the job of a critic, and you are a critic as well. Suppose I say something in the class which you do not like, and you can definitely argue with me, present your views. So that is the point I am trying to make. So when you make deeper engagement with the review, and when you do your review recording, what I want you to do is, I want you to talk about not only what is good, but about areas where you disagree with the author, areas where you feel that the author could have better depicted certain characters, areas where the author could have been more objective rather than being subjective. So these are some of the aspects you need to analyze, I mean, in your book review. And to just revisit the metaphor of going deep into the ocean and looking below the surface. Now, how do we look below the surface? Like, A, you need to have a very balanced analysis. When I say balanced analysis, I want you to think about the first point. Avoid voicing strong agreement or disagreement. Okay, I think we can better re-emphasize when one of you read each sentences with the clarity so that we can reflect on how to do a review. So may I request Anna to please read these sentences, ma? Maybe very loudly.
Sir.
Yes, Anna.
Yes.
Sir. Yes, Anna.
Analysis tips. Present a balanced analysis. Avoid voicing strong agreement or disagreement. Harsh judgments are difficult to prove and can give readers the sense that you are unfair in your assessment. You must look below the surface and focus on the deeper issues present in the book or article. As you read, constantly evaluate what you have read and make notes of your questions and thoughts.
Thank you very much. You have such a wonderful voice, very clearly articulated. So,
Thank you, sir.
Please reflect on those things. See, as I told you before, you can either voice your agreement or disagreement. A lot of people today carelessly express their views whenever they disagree, which fuels the argument, which results in some kind of vociferous arguments. Or sometimes, if you are an irresponsible critic, you may be, your career may be at stake. So whenever you voice your agreements, you can be very frank. But whenever you disagree, you need to use a language that is acceptable, a language that is polite, a language that is not offensive. Because it is one thing to call an idea a stupid idea, and another thing to say how it could be better expressed. So that is the point I'm trying to make. So always voice very strong agreement or disagreement, but be very subtle in your disagreement. Because, you know, harsh judgments are difficult to prove, and it can give the readers the sense that you are unfair in your assessment. So don't be unfair. So the only way not to be unfair is to be very polite in what you express. So the other points are what we discussed already. But look at the final point. As you read, constantly evaluate what you have read and make notes of your questions and thoughts. See, what I do is usually whenever I read a book, you know, when I get deeply engaged with the text, to read for pleasure is one thing, but to read it for a review is another thing. I'm sure that most of you have read for pleasure, but first time you are going to revisit your favorite book and do the job of a critic, you are going to evaluate. But whenever you evaluate your book, the way you evaluate is different. So what you need to do is, wherever you agree, you will not remember. So make some short notes of the page numbers. If there are certain passages you want to highlight, highlight and keep it, and then revisit them. And maybe wherever you want to critic, if you want to critic, underline those things in pink. Wherever you want to echo certain feelings where you have to really appreciate that particular author, you know, highlight that in yellow. So have your own distinctions. So, but ultimately the point I am trying to make is, you know, you should constantly evaluate, and one reading you cannot be a critic. You need to come and revisit certain passages, understand deeper aspects of the text. I hope I am making my point clear to you. Am I, ma?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So we are just coming to the last part of the review. So you have to ask these questions when you analyze. You know, when you make analysis questions, who is your audience? Like, did the author communicate effectively to the audience? For example, I'm giving you an example. Suppose the author writes child fiction, okay, children's literature. And let us say you come across certain passages that are not suitable for the children. So, did the author understand or address the genre purposes? Did he actually try to fulfill the requirements of the particular audience? It is not only for a talk, it is also for writing. Sometimes writers get too carried away that even sometimes they express certain things which are not suitable for that age. So again, when you are discussing something very political, so you know, what is the kind of arguments that you place on the table? So you have to be very careful about those things. Very importantly, every author who writes may bring some notions which are preconceived, some preconceived ideas. But my humble request to you is, when you read a particular text, you may take your experience, but don't have preconceived ideas about the text. Don't think that this particular text, this is my experience. This is what the author has conveyed there. This is what the author has conveyed in the text. So please don't go to the extreme and don't have any preconceived notions about the text. So be very particular about that. So to finally reflect on the analysis questions, I want you to think about the rhetorics of Aristotle, ethos, pathos, and logos. When we talk about logos, in what way is the writer an apt person to write that particular book? Which means, does the author have the necessary expertise to write the book article? Argue about that. Okay, present some views. Why do you think that that particular author is really suitable for writing that type of genre? Please mention that. Okay, so that is one important point you need to mention. So to ultimately sum up what we have discussed so far, so these are the questions you need to ask. What is the purpose of the book? And most importantly, make some comment on the book title. Does sometimes you may look at a title, the title may really appeal to you, but after reading it, the title and the book will not have any correlation. You may have a feeling. Sometimes you will go and watch a particular movie looking at its title, but the title and the movie will not have any correlation. It is like you go to a bookstore, some covers will truly appeal to you. You pick the cover and many times what is inside the book will be a crap. I don't know how many of you have experienced this. You know, I have sometimes come across these self-help manuals, how to reprogram your mind in 1 week, scientific tips. You kind of take that book and read. First thing you understand is the author does not have the expertise to write that. Because he is not a psychologist, he is not a scientist in human psychology, saying something which is based on his experience, which you may not agree. So have you come across such experiences in life, Ma, where you have judged a book by its cover? Have you ever done that?
Yes, sir. Sometimes there will be videos or even books like that, sir. The cover would say, you can do so and so things in 30 days, in 45 days. You can change your character and all that,
sir. Yeah. Absolutely, Anna. That's the point. And this happens mostly in YouTube videos, right? YouTube videos. Whenever we watch the YouTube videos, it's titled in such a way that you are so allured, but you just go inside that and it's just crap. And what it promises is different. So you, as a critic, comment, did the book deliver what it promised in terms of genre, in terms of audience, in terms of age, and in terms of the particular message? So I leave it to you. As I said, one final point I would like to make is, there is no fixed framework for doing a review. I mean, if you do the 4 activities which I gave you in the earlier classes, that is enough for doing a review. So there is no particular framework, no universal framework for doing a review. But the only thing is your analysis of the strengths, of its weaknesses, what is good in it, what is bad in it, what are something that really appeals to you, and only these aspects that we have discussed so far. I would like to end my class with a particular analysis of a classic, narrative written by Walter Lord. If you happen to read this book, please read. It is called A Night to Remember, where he gives a classic account on the final hours of Titanic. You know, the final hours before it sank. It's a beautiful book. It just describes how before, you know, 12 hours before how this Titanic sank. And what I want you to do, remember, is look at the blurb of the book. Can I have a volunteer to please read this blurb? Can one of you please read? This is the blurb. Can one of you please read this blurb? Yes, Anna, can you please, Anna?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
A Night to Remember, first published in 1955. A Night to Remember remains a completely riveting account of the Titanic's fatal collision and the behavior of the passengers and crew, both noble and ignominious. Some sacrificed their lives, while others fought like animals for their own survival. Wives beseeched husbands to join them in lifeboats. Gentlemen went taut-lipped to their deaths in full evening dress. And hundreds of steerage passengers trapped below decks sought help in vain.
Yes. See, this is a beautiful blurb of that particular book on how the same incident brings out different type of behavior, different characteristics. If you see in that movie when Titanic sinks, some people would have just sacrificed their lives for others. But others are fighting like animals to save their own life. Some wives are just forsaking their husbands to just jump into the lifeboat. But some gentlemen used to actually sacrifice their life. You can see gentlemen were taut-lipped to their deaths in their full evening dress. Now, I want you to do an interesting activity. I'm sure all of you would have watched the movie Titanic. Now, I want you to reflect on that particular movie, or to even once again witness that movie and write a small blurb about that movie, your own blurb. This is the activity that I would like to leave you with. Okay. So I want you to leave you with this particular activity when you come across, when we meet in our next class. You know, small blurb of, what you understand about the movie. What do you think is a central message? So whatever we have been discussing in the last two classes, you have to encapsulate the quintessence of it and put it in a paragraph. Say what the book is about, what the novel is about. Now, I don't want you to read the book. I want you to reflect on Titanic and kind of express your emotions in a paragraph. All right, I think with this, I'll stop for the day and very quickly take the comments of Anna and Balachandar. Balachandar, nice to see you. I hope Balachandar, were you here in the last class, Balachandar? Hello, Balachandar, were you here in the last class? Okay. All right. I would like to hear from both Anna and Balachandar. First, I'll take Anna's views and then I'll take Balachandar's opinions. Yes, please go ahead, Anna.
Yes. So the book I read was A Sun is Also a Star. And the book blurb goes like this. Basically, there are two main characters, which is Natasha and Daniel. So the book is written in a way where Natasha's opinions is also, written as Natasha. And then Daniel's opinions also written as in the title Daniel. So the book blurb goes like this. Natasha, I'm a girl who believes in science and facts, not fate, not destiny, or dreams that will never come true. I'm definitely not the kind of girl who meets a cute boy on a crowded New York City street and falls in love with him. Not when my family is 12 hours away from being deported to Jamaica. Falling in love with him won't be my story. Daniel, I've always been the good son, the good student, living up to my parents' expectations. Never the poet or the dreamer, but when I see her, I forget about all that. Something about Natasha makes me think that fate has something much more extraordinary in store for both of us. The universe. Every moment in our lives has brought us to this single moment. A million futures lie before us. Which one will come true? So this is the book blurb, and the summary is this. So this is the story of how two teens meet and spend 12 fateful hours together in New York City. And Natasha has only 24 hours until her family is deported back to Jamaica. She does all the things she could to make her family stay in New York City, and that's when she bumps into Daniel. Daniel Bay, on the other hand, wants to be a poet, but feels forced to make his parents happy and attends a college interview with a Yale alum. So since he's into Yale, we come to know that he's a smart guy. And Natasha is like very logical and science-oriented, while he is a romantic at heart. He persuades her to try to see whether they can fall in love scientifically by answering a series of questions, which promotes intimacy. And at last, they did fall in love. So there were basically 40 questions, 35 to be precise. But since they didn't have time, they asked only like 15 to 20 questions. And the final task was to stare in the eye straight for like 4 minutes without any distraction. And that's when they knew, especially Natasha knew, that she was in love with him. And they cannot bear the separation. And 10 years later, coincidentally, they end up on the same plane. So Daniel and Natasha meet at that time. And that's how the story ends. My favorite passage, there was this chapter called A Chemical History in this. So Natasha is into science, right? So she explains about love in chemical terms, like, you know, in chemistry terms and stuff. So it goes like this. Oxytocin and vasopressin control the third stage, which is attachment and long-term bonding. Oxytocin is released during orgasm and makes you feel close to the person you have a connect with. So it's also released during childbirth and helps bond mother to child. Vasopressin is released post-coitally. Natasha knows these facts cold. Knowing them helped her get over Rob's betrayal. Rob is someone she was in love with before and got Rob cheated her. So she knows. Love is just chemicals and coincidence. So why does Daniel feel like something more? So the last line was my favorite line because Daniel felt something more. So he clearly proved to her that it's not about science and chemicals. Love is something more than that. This is the first romantic novel I read, and it has been my favorite ever since. Yes, sir.
Truly, truly fascinating. Actually, you know, those kind of verses you articulated are so trenchant. Actually, you know, the way that it is expressed, I don't think anybody could have expressed so profoundly about such feelings and emotions. Speaking, you know, in chemical terms, because that very much defines what composition we are made of. It's truly appealing. I was just listening to you with rapt attention, especially the beautiful blurb that you wrote and also the lines that have really captivated you. And Anna, no doubt it captivated me as well. So I was really thrilled to listen to you. Yeah, but I... 1 minute. Huh? So I would just like to listen to... Balachandar as well, because, you know, Balachandar also